and welcome to the FinTech Finance Virtual Arena. In today's talk, we're going to be discussing about the future of the payments ecosystem. And if there's one part of finance that's gone through a wealth of changes over the last couple of years, it's got to be payments. So I'm really excited to see where this goes in the future. So joining me today, I have Andre Vitrosky from Netcetera and Gabriel Bougat from Giesecke and Devrient. Guys, thank you so much for joining me today. Please, I think the best way to kick things off, could you give our viewers a bit of background to yourselves and your roles, please? If I could start with Gabriel, please.
Yes, for sure. So I'm Gabriel Bougat, and I'm heading the e-payments business and initiatives inside GND. What it covers is the issuance of payment cards. It's also the issuance of digital credentials for digital payments. But it's also the technologies like authentication or identification that nowadays we need in our payments journey. And at GND, this is really a business that we've been doing for years, I would almost say for a century, to secure assets. It started with securing banknotes, then securing communication assets, securing cards and payments, and eventually securing the digital euro that we would have one day. So that's what we're doing. We want to be a one-stop shop for payments, and for that we're ready to expand our offering and to partner with key technology companies like Netcetera.
Amazing. Well, thank you so much. I'm looking forward to hearing especially some of those future ideas nestled in there. And Andre, thank you so much for joining as well. Could you give our viewers a bit of background to yourself, your role, and Netcetera, please?
Yes, I'm glad to do so. So I'm Andre. I'm one of the co-founders and currently CEO of Netcetera, which is a software shop headquartered in Zurich, Switzerland. We are a little bit more than 700 people in various locations around the globe. I started in Switzerland about 25 years ago. We are specializing in B2B2C software, so we are providing our software to companies that then use our software to interact with the customers in several specified segments, such as banking, publishing, and also last but not least, payment. Payment is one of our specialties where we have a lot of products to make, for example, payment more convenient, but also secure at the same time, or mobile banking, digital payment and stuff like that.
Incredible. So, you know, I think with that in mind, then, Andre, if I could stay with you, first of all, I think we can all say the payments have become instant, digital, even mobile as well. So I'd be interested to hear what you think, in your perspective, has been the defining innovation in the payments industry within the last couple of years.
As we've grown more digital and a lot of payments are also going on in the online space, I think that's obviously to find there. We could name obviously the everything is around cryptocurrency as one of those innovations, and obviously it fueled a lot of valuation in the recent months. But I consider actually from my perspective as really a defining part is the introduction of tokenization, because tokenization is the thing that takes away that number that we sometimes call credit card number away from the payment process, and that has been for tens of years both tedious for everyone who wanted to provide security in the online space, and it took really a long time to get to a step where we can actually and finally get rid of that number which is embossed on the plastic.
Yeah, I think tokenization really does seem to be at the heart of how we're going to define payments going forward. So that's really interesting. And Gabriel, could you also give your insight onto this? You know, what do you see as the defining innovation in payments recently?
So innovations come from ideas. And in fact, the value of an idea is of using it. What we've seen a lot of innovation, a lot of good ideas, a few innovation that went to market and not that many that went mass market. So I think that behind innovation is really how customers are using the whatever we design or think. And what I've seen over the years is that our usages as customer habits are changing. So we always have to anticipate and stay ahead of those habits. But when it comes to payments, there's a few things that will never change. Is yes, we want to make it easier, but we want to keep it secure. And what I think in terms of innovation has been great is we've been able to evolve, making all those security and the technology less visible, but at the same time, keeping the security. Tokenization is this, is the journey is really smooth, but behind this, the underlying security is high. And there's a lot of technologies like this, of innovation that are being put on the market that combine the convenience and the security. One example is the biometric, the use of biometric in mobile payments or even in card payments. At first, it was to make it easy, smooth. But then behind that, we're using PSD2, we're using a lot of very, very regulated, very specified, very strong authentication with the combination of, you know, the two-factor authentication, who you are and what you have. So all in all, I think those innovations, the best innovation is the innovation you don't see because it fits your needs as a user and you can, while you can still sleep at night, your money is safe.
If I may add here, I mean, some people say, okay, disruption, that's the key, you know, and that's where the big money is and investors like that. But exactly adding to what Gabriel said, that the example of tokenization is a good example because it leverages a lot of pre-existing concepts and technology under the hood. Yes, it adds more security, it provides more convenience and everything, but some of the concepts are still there. And these concepts, they allow such a token technology like tokenization also to go to mass market because you don't have to roll out an entire new system to all merchants and to all places where you pay, but you can reuse and leverage a lot of what's existing. And I think that's the key in these areas. You have to combine somehow what's already there and extend it with good new ideas, and then there is a path to success.
Yeah, I think that you both bring up such an interesting point there, in the fact that it seems to be this golden egg in terms of finding the balance between enhanced security but also enhanced convenience for the customer, which ultimately will be such an important part in innovating and making payments really exciting for everyone. Now, with that in mind, beyond the established players, there are also several new, I want to use the phrase, new kids on the block. So, I mean, if I could come to Gabriel first for this one, what role will the tech giants play in our new payments ecosystem?
So, not that long ago, I used to go to the branch, talk to my clerk and have financial advice on how to use my money. This now is disappearing. Technology is playing a bigger part and a super strong part. So of course it opens the way for big tech giants. They can come and they've done a tremendous, great job in improving the user experience, in also putting on the same platform the goods to pay, to buy, and the payment means, and in exploiting the data. So definitely they brought a lot of new technologies, but now it's not because we have technology that every local needs are met. It's not because we have fast food that my taste for trattoria food is met. So you need a combination of know-how. And that's for the big tech. But we also have, we can see a lot of small techs coming on board, more the fintechs, bringing some interesting adjustment, especially on the UX side, on user experience side, on the front end. But the back end does not change that much. And that's what Andre was also saying, is that it's like this, it's the tip of the iceberg changes, but the back end is still there. And it's really a combination of good technology coming from small tech, from big tech, and a bit of financial technical expertise from companies like ours.
Yeah, Andre, do you agree that there's still this classic role of trust and expertise that the financial players can play in this new ecosystem that Gabriel was just saying?
Totally. I mean, the key word here is trust. I mean, especially in payment, trust is what you have to provide, and trust has kind of a rational, objective side to it. So, how good is the technology, security? But it has also a perception side, and the perception side is as important to that. And I'm not saying that, for example, what the tech giants are doing is not trustful. To the contrary, I think what they managed is really to provide not only a good framework of technology, but they also provide it to be a source of trust. But that does not cover everything that people need. So I do also see this space as an interesting, I would say, cooperation and competition space for all of us.
Yeah, with that in mind then, I think it'd be interesting to have a little kind of a thought experiment on this discussion then. You know, how would you, Andre, how would you design an ideal retail payment ecosystem if it's designed by choice effectively?
Well, obviously, I would take all of our technology that we have in our backpack and the colleagues of G&T, and then we would have about 80% of what it takes. No, being more serious, it would be a dream of all of us to start completely on a green field. But I think what's really important to be as fast as possible on the market, and to be as fast as possible on the market means you have to reuse a lot of things that are already there. You don't have to reinvent all the wheels that are in that machine, but only those that do differentiate. For example, there is a European initiative to bring up a new payment system. And what I really like about that initiative, that they said, okay, the settlement and the clearing part of the payment transaction, which consists of a lot of steps, we keep that based on existing, well-established and recently modernized standards. So we don't have to make everything new. So we try to make those things new that make a difference, but keep also the legacy or the tradition somewhere. So I would try to find really the good mix between what's existing and where we can make a change.
I can only relate to that. There's no green field. We would all prefer being technical experts. It would be great to create infrastructure from scratch, but the truth is it's way too expensive. People in payments may not be ready to change habits overnight. So it's more about building layers, adjusting, adapting on top of existing infrastructure. And EPI is a very good example of thinking, how can we reuse? How can we build on top? What are the habits or the infrastructure that is already in place? We have POS, we have people used to having something in their mind, in their hands, or mobile in the pocket. So how can we leverage on what costs a lot, but add more the software part and the design on that can bring new use cases? And in EPI, it's quite an adventure. It's quite a European initiative. And I guess that lots of, and I'm sure companies like us, European companies like us, would really like to contribute to such an initiative.
Yeah, that's. I think you both bring up a very interesting point, and I think a lot of banks would actually quite like to hear this. Large financial institutions, that is the fact that, and it's the kind of the tip of the iceberg. You change the back end gently and it slowly filters out, but also you still need to have the heart of the bank unchanged, because that is where the trust comes from. Now, Andre, do you have any following up to what Gabrielle was just saying?
Well, I'm basically just can confirm that it is in the end a clever mix and match of existing and new stuff, and then obviously every innovator would say no, we have, you know, to break things to make great things happen. But it really depends on what you're looking at. And payment is in essence a network business, because you have to connect merchants, you have to connect the consumers, and this network business is not something that's built overnight. So that means being early on the market and then evolve with the market is of key importance, and so you can only do that if you if you combine existing experience what's there together with these new ideas, even if the markets do, or if market regulation helps there a little bit. I mean, we've seen that in many places on the planet that nations or whatever try to regulate the markets a little bit to or also fight a little bit against oligopolies or giants or something. But even then, building on a basic standard technology helps. I mean, that's basically how the internet rose, right? I mean, when we started to use the internet commercially, it was already used for 15 years in the science community, and there were already existing ways how computers communicate, what the principles are, and all these things, and that helped then the internet also to become a commercial entity.
Interesting, it does play into that narrative that trust is so important, especially when you're dealing with payments, because it is people connecting, and it is ultimately at the end of the day a lot of money going across various different data channels and payment rails. Now, I'm then going to kind of throw a disruption into this discussion. And if Gabrielle, if I could come to you first, do you think because of this demand for trust within the payments industry, has the payments industry before the last maybe 5 years been guilty of just repackaging old concepts and old technologies because they know that the consumer demand just hasn't been there?
Yes and no. We know that innovation, it's really sometimes it's combining things that were already existing to do something else. So existing technologies, reusing existing technologies is not being guilty. It's being clever and it's being self cost conscious. So a lot of the things that's been going on is just it's really rethinking existing technologies, combining with and adding new layers on top. But it's really rethinking having the consumers in mind. So it's you cannot disrupt that much. So you really have to think clever, especially when you have quite a legacy in place. Yeah. So you really have to think, what can I do with what I have in front of me? And of course, we have new technologies and blockchain, and we have new things that would come on top, and it's great. But you still have to do with what you have in front of you and complement. So it's disruption within evolution.
Yeah, and I think that's so critical in a regulated industry, is that gradual evolution. Those two different words, gradual and evolution, it's so important to the financial industry. And Andre, can I get your input on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the key words here is also agility to that. I mean, if you want to gradually evolve, you have also to be agile enough to correct your course. If it's needed, sometimes you might also do some innovations that don't work, or that where the adoption that doesn't work, and so it is a constant adaptation to the adoption, if you wish, on the markets. And I mean, if Kodak would have been more agile, then they would have found their way into digital photography once they have been the tech guy and giant of chemical films. And so I think it is not a principle mindset question, am I disrupting or am I sustaining innovation, but it is a question on how agile you can be in this world that changes around us. We can try to make plans and foresee the future, but at least we don't have that mythical crystal ball in our box. And the answer to that, also for a trust industry like bank, is to be sufficiently agile. Not more than that, but sufficiently agile.
Yeah, and I think that ultimately will protect the consumers going forward, not having their money suddenly sent in completely different ways. But I love the Kodak kind of moment there, that maybe they didn't innovate and they didn't have the mindset, but they didn't do it in the right way. So
Kodak even had the digital camera, but they were so successful with their standard product, so that they didn't focus enough on the on the new world. And I mean, if you haven't, I would recommend you the book about the innovator's dilemma. That's a good read on that.
Well, I think you bring up a really exciting and interesting point, because we are starting to see central bank digital currencies actually being enacted around the world. For instance, the Chinese central bank has decided to greenlit its e-yuan or its e-kuai model. And I'd be really interested, Andre, if I could get your opinion on this. Do you think that the ECB is going to follow suit? And you know, Gabrielle's already brought up maybe the fact that it's this perfect kind of parallel system that can offer choice. You know, what do you think that having an e-euro could bring to consumers?
Well, I'm pretty sure that we will see central bank digital currencies around the globe, everywhere, because I mean, it is kind of an obvious thing, as the paper as a security for your assets has to be replaced or complemented by digital means, and the payment card is not really a replacement for that. So this will for certain happen, but it will also for certain happen not in a disruptive sense, only integrated and interoperable sense. So it will be part of, I would say, the global ecosystem payment. There will be multiple digital currencies on the planet, and a lot of central banks are also working on that, and we will see that in Europe for the euro, or in the country where I am, also the Swiss National Bank is thinking about things, and there will be also a little bit of competition there, as we see it also in the cryptocurrency world. There will be also maybe some disappointments, but that kind of with a North Star like distance, this will happen.
Interesting. I Gabrielle, just before I come over to you, because I'd love to hear your perspective, obviously, from Giesecke and Devron on this, is and I'll throw this out to both of you. And if central bank digital currencies are in nature a digital currency, what is to stop them from being global? And as a result, if that is the case, this is coming from someone who isn't fully clued up on them, What's to stop the country that the central bank that creates the first and biggest one gaining market share, and people just, for instance, using the e-yuan rather than their own central bank digital currency?
Well, I mean, this goes into politics, right? And I think maintaining an own currency is an important part of any political system, whether that's European Union or a group of countries in the European Union or other countries, because controlling, for example, the amount of money that's on the market is a tool that currently the national banks are using to control inflation, or at least to try to steer it. I mean, there is maybe a lot of political discussion, but then I'm by no means an expert on this topic. But I think there is sufficient national interest of these central banks to control the currency, and therefore also to provide kind of a digital alternative to it.
It's a matter of, it's a matter of payment sovereignty. And if by analogy with what we see in the card payment business, there are some global schemes and some local schemes. And we're still working with a lot of local schemes, and you have schemes in Russia, you have schemes in Nigeria, in China, in Europe, of course, in Canada. There's a lot of local schemes, and those local schemes have enabled an ecosystem for domestic digital transactions. So when it comes to digital currencies, it's going to be the same. This national sovereignty is quite important. It could be national at the level of a country, on national or more regional, like this European Payment Initiative we were talking about just before. What one more thing I wanted to mention regarding CBDC, regarding those digital currency aspect. It's a good example of what we were discussing before, innovation, because it's new technologies. So based most of them based on blockchain. You have the latest and greatest of crypto. But the truth is, because we are in a few pilots, in advanced pilots worldwide, truth is we are using well-known and quite almost traditional interfaces. You pay, at the end of the day, you pay with a mobile or you pay with a dedicated hardware. That's not that much different from what you're doing today. It's just that the content, in essence, is a digital currency. It's not the money from your account. So it's a combination of things that new techno, but also old techno at the same time. And it has to work. So it has to work with the different players. You need to find a way where you get the money, where you transfer the money. So it's also the ecosystem that has to make it work. Slowly adjusting, finding the new role for everyone, and but no doubt working together because it's all connected.
Yeah, and I think that's a really interesting point. It is being resonated throughout this whole discussion in the fact that I wouldn't say old technology, but it's old experience and it's good experience, and building on that to create a service that's just better than that has been before. So I guess to close on a personal note and look really to the future, Andre, if I could come to you first, what inspires you when it comes to innovation and new business ideas, especially within the payments industry?
It would be my wish if we could come up with payment technologies that make payments as trustful and secure and at the same time as convenient as possible. And I mean, you were mentioning the gold neck. We all know that it is not possible to do so, because if you make things more secure, they are less convenient and vice versa. But I'm still positive that with new technologies, with new inventions and innovations, we will be able to make the payment actually just a commodity as an element at the end of a business transaction, so that you pay but you don't worry about it, and you're sure that everything's secure and no one is stealing your money, and it is not a big thing. And we are then below the surface working like hell to make this happen, but the consumers, they don't have to be worried about that.
Yeah, that's such a key point, because people don't, at the end of it, care about a payment. They only care when it doesn't work. Yep. It's almost a thankless industry. So, Gabrielle, could I also get your perspective, you know, when it comes to your personal opinion, when it comes to innovation and new business ideas within payments, please?
Yes. Just to close on what Andre was saying, is that our job is done when everything goes fine. So it's kind of hidden champion. And when we are in the truth is, when we are in this payment technology business, the world is our sandbox. And it's what passionates me, because every country is different. It's technology meeting culture and habits. And in every country can bring a new set of challenges. You have countries where you have leapfrog from no infrastructure to really advanced infrastructure. You have countries where the challenge is to deal with a very old legacy. You have countries where it's more credit, where it's more debit. And GND being an international company with people in different places, and I can say I've worked in different continents, and it's so diverse the way people pay. Having the world as a sandbox is what I found really great in this payment industry, and getting everybody to think, rethink, transform the technology, bringing new innovation on the fields to our customers, and sometimes bringing innovation that was thought in Philippines and presented in Canada. That's this kind of payment collective intelligence is what really inspires me.
It's such an exciting ecosystem, because it's not just technology led. It's come into something very different, almost cultural. So do you think, and I'll have a follow-up question that I'll ask both of you, Andre, if I could come to you first then. Do you think we might see these local payment methods come together ultimately as people take different cultural ideas of how to pay and how they like to pay? Or do you think we're going to see payments around the world diverge continually, like we've seen, for instance, in some parts of Asia using a QR code that hasn't caught on in Europe? Do you think we're going to see local payment methods diverge or converge?
What I think we will have convergence for the global payment schemes and the technologies around that, but we'll still have very strong local variants to that and local options to that, because even if you're somewhere, say in Asia, in a local ecosystems, you might want to consume global services, global online services, maybe subscribe to a US service or something like that. So you want to be a player in the global world, but then for local things, you will have specialties and diversions, and that's what makes also our life interesting. So you know, payment will not be finished and invented in 2 years and then we can retire. So that there will be always local specialties, local innovations. We will maybe be more and more in the underground and people won't see us anymore, but that combination of kind of global standardized ways to do and then local counterparts, that's what we are going to see.
Amazing. And Gabrielle, would you also agree?
I don't see convergence coming anytime soon. We are so different. I had an experience once with someone from Finland, someone from US in the same room. And really, even though they were speaking both English, they were not speaking about the same thing when it comes to payment, because one country is heavily credit, is credit intensive, and the other country credits is, they said, we can't spend what we don't have. And just with this sentence, he understands that convergence will not happen. But then what is sure is that innovations will happen. And innovation having a cost, the challenge for us is to have common platforms on which you can have local customizations so that each and every country can keep their cultural specificities, but benefiting from the latest and greatest of technology and a technology that protects against the frauds. Because one thing that is sure is that fraudsters will always be there and they will always be quite innovative in the way they attack the big systems.
Well, yeah, I completely agree there. The fraudsters are just always going to keep changing. So it really does sound like you have your work cut out for you to stay ahead of that curve. And it's a really interesting discussion, guys. I think that's all we have time for. But thank you for your input on the digital euro, the EPI. It's going to be a really exciting time for payments. And I'm, for one, very excited to see where all this new technology and payment culture goes in the future. So once again, thank you so much for your input. And also to all our viewers, thank you for watching. You can catch the rest of the series and much more over at www.fintechf.com. And of course, YouTube and LinkedIn, where I'll see you in the comments. Thanks very much and goodbye. You